The most important thing is your mind. Make no mistake about that. Right now, the only thing that is holding you back, I promise you, and whatever excuse you're telling yourself, it's bullshit. The only thing that's holding you back is the way that you think about yourself and the world. That's it, flat. You have not built the mechanisms in your mind that you need to free yourself from the matrix. And boys and girls, the matrix has you.
The matrix has you.
And until you can identify it, until you can see that you're telling yourself lies, and they are disempowering lies, by the way.
Because I am not some grand fan of the truth.
I'm a grand fan of doing and believing that which moves you towards your goals. Do and believe that which moves you towards your goals. That's it. Once you put that belief at the core of your being, you will be amazed at what you're able to accomplish. When I say take the red pill, what I'm talking about is waking up to the way the world really is.
When I say take the red pill, take the red pill.
Hold in your puke. We've only just started.
The Fresh and Fit podcast serves as a marketing vehicle for Rollo Tomassi and his successful book and blog, The Rational Male, which spells out red pill theory with a supposed scientific backing. I couldn't imagine having a husband who's drawn a sexual market value graph, especially one that starts at age 15.
Guys, no matter what their age, 13, 73, they find women who are 22 attractive.
So I want to talk about what you call sexual market value.
Sexual market value.
On this, I'm just completely unafraid. Like, if people get upset, like, that makes me sad because they are rejecting something that is just true about the human experience.
As I wrote, I realized that this is akin to what many might call the red pill, being awakened to the reality of what gender performance really is for men and boys. And I argue that this is where you begin to see the development of nihilistic or antisocial ideologies in some men, AKA edgy boy behavior, when they don't have the best coping strategies for this realization. More than anything, the manosphere is about reifying and affirming the status quo, especially as it pertains to men. The status quo tells us that men should be this assortment of traits society has deemed appropriate for men. In fact, not being this assortment of traits as a man is why you're unhappy. And more importantly,
my product, which you can find here on the Manosphere, whether it be advice, some type of content, a special soap, a vitamin regimen, a special type of workout, whatever it is, can help you be
better at this assortment of masculine traits.
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of Conversations with Tom. I am here with somebody that I have been so desperate to get on the show for a long time. I cannot tell you just how much. The one and only Jordan Peterson. Jordan, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
Have you ever accidentally made a joke that predicted the future? Were you ever trying to just make a really lame pun or a really stupid dad joke, and then next thing you know, the thing you were joking about actually turns out to be real? You know that meme that's like, ha 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 ha, just kidding, unless? But then the unless part actually comes true? Yeah, I did that this past week on Your Morning Guru.
He's got a triangle going down his face, and it looks like he's trying to do some kind of like incel face shape science over here. But anyway, here's Tom.
I don't know what you mean either.
You know how there's like incel science? We're like,
I'm unfamiliar with incel science too.
They have this whole like fake science that they push on the internet about how people have different face shapes that indicate their breedability. It has to do, they like measure their different proportions of their faces and look at the symmetry and things like that. And they're like, oh, this is why Chad is able to get all these girls, because he has the right facial proportions. He was just born with that. I'll never have the right facial proportions like Chad, so I have absolutely no chance. Yeah, and that's how they keep themselves down.
A Chad skull, an incel skull. I mean, this looks really scientific.
Anyway, Tom is not doing that. That's what I first thought of when I saw the
way. I forgot why we started that conversation.
He has this weird triangle going through his face that's like going down through the center and then like pointing outwards. Like, it looks like he's trying to measure himself.
I think he just wanted to add some texture to the photo, Sam.
I want to talk about what you call sexual market value.
No, not the sexual market. And now he's literally talking about sexual market value, which is a red pill conspiracy theory.
When I say take the red pill, what I'm talking about is waking up to the way the world really is.
And now he's literally talking about sexual market value, which is a red pill conspiracy theory. And Lisa's over here like, so we're going to talk about what you call sexual market value. Not just him who calls it that. It is a big time red pill conspiracy theory. Okay, so yesterday when I was, guys, what Derek says right here, his jaw isn't square enough to be talking. Yesterday when I was looking at his website and I was like, this triangle going through his face really looks like incel science. And everyone thought I was just going off on a weird tangent.
Yeah, I thought you were on a weird tangent.
Dude,
I think you're
that,
right.
Like, I knew something. I knew something was up. This man is a
you have awareness, Sammy. It all goes back to
because
you.
Because I have awareness. Dude. I'm... Also, the Matrix was a documentary shirt is a little sus, to say the least. So that prompted me to change up today's video topic. Originally, I was going to review Lisa Bilyeu's new book, Radical Confidence, today. Instead, I'm going to be doing that next week. Today, instead, I'm going to be focusing on Lisa's husband, Tom Bilyeu. Tom Bilyeu, one of the founders of the multi-billion dollar protein company Quest Nutrition, current host of the podcast Impact Theory, and overall self-help guru. A machine learning program that someone fed 10,000 hours of Gary Vee, Tony Robbins, Grant Cardone, Jordan Peterson, and more. And as I looked more into Tom Bilyeu, a lot of the things that I heard him say started to set off alarm bells. Bright red alarm sirens. Giant red flags crushed into little pieces of red dust, then packaged into small red capsules.
Meant for you to swallow.
And that's when I realized that I needed to dive into this topic for today. Is Tom Bilyeu intentionally or unintentionally spouting manosphere conspiracy theories? Is Tom a men's rights activist masquerading as a feminist ally? Has Tom Bilyeu swallowed the red pill? And what do any of these terms that I just said even mean? Stick around as we dive into today's topic. Tom Bilyeu, businessman or covert red piller?
Get you some nuts.
There was lots of memes. Makes me wonder if I should take up lesbianism.
Chicago.
You guys asked for it.
What's up, my fellow small business supporters? I'm Savvy, and welcome back to Savvy Writes Books, the channel where we talk about books and business. Today was gonna be a book review, but instead it led into a more business-adjacent topic, as we are going to talk about a wildly successful businessman turned successful business guru, turned maybe a little bit of something else as well. If you're new here, please don't forget to subscribe, because every Friday morning at 11 a.m. Central, I put out new videos about books and business. And if you're interested in more longer form type of conversations about similar topics, then don't forget to check out my second channel, Your Morning Guru, which is my morning live show, live stream that I run with my friend every morning, where we delve into more of these topics on a live show with more audience participation. It's a lot of fun. We're about to unpack this topic, but first, let's unpack a word from our sponsor. Today's video is sponsored by Magic Spoon, a high protein brand of breakfast cereals that come in a variety of fun flavors. One of the things I talk about a lot on my second channel, Your Morning Guru, is how having a daily morning stream has helped me develop my own morning routine that I can rely on. And now, part of that morning routine includes having a bowl of high-protein cereal before I get started on my workday, especially in the cinnamon or fruity flavors, which are my favorites. Magic Spoon recently sent me some cereal bars as well, which have been an excellent mid-morning snack to have on my walk over to the gym. One serving in a bowl of Magic Spoon cereal has 13 to 14 grams of protein and only 4 to 5 net grams of carbs per serving, and only about 140 calories per serving. It also has 0 grams of sugar per serving, with the exception of the honey nut flavor, which has 1 gram of sugar per serving because they use real honey to make it. Magic Spoon's new cereal bars also have 1 gram of sugar, 10 grams of protein, 4 net grams of carbs, and only 130 calories per cereal bar. They're keto-friendly, gluten-free, grain-free, soy-free, and low-carb. So click the link below to get some Magic Spoon cereal today. You can build your very own variety box and use my code SAVVY for $5 off. Choose from the best-selling cocoa, fruity, frosted, peanut butter, cookies and cream, and maple waffle flavors, plus other awesome flavors, including the honey nut one that I mentioned earlier, blueberry muffin, and cinnamon roll, my favorite. You can also add the cookies and cream and cocoa peanut butter flavor cereal bars to your variety box as well, if you want to eat a cereal bar as a snack.
Magic Spoon is so confident in their product that it's backed with a 100% happiness guarantee. So if you don't like it for any reason, they'll refund you your money, no questions asked. And for my viewers in the UK and Canada, Magic Spoon is now shipping to you guys as well. So click the link below and use the code SAVVY for $5 off, or go to magicspoon.com/savvy to save $5 on your order today. Thank you to Magic Spoon for sponsoring today's video. Thank you also to all of my Patreon supporters for continuing to support this channel. Patreon supporters who give $5 a month and up are linked in the description below, where you can check out their own websites, social media, causes, anything like that that they want to link. I appreciate you guys so much. Now let's talk about Tom Bilyeu. Tom Bilyeu is what would happen if Dave Hollis had a secret love child with Tommy Wiseau. Let me explain. Dave Hollis was a 26-year-old man in a position of power over 18-year-old Rachel Neely, whom he married anyway, tried to force into the traditional role of stay-at-home motherhood, until that woman said, "Fuck it, I'm Rachel Hollis, bitch," and became a self-help guru herself. Then the two of them created their own podcasts each, plus their own couples podcast, where they gave out basic bitch relationship advice for clout. Tom Bilyeu was a 23-year-old film teacher in a position of power over his 21-year-old student, Lisa Charlotte Lambos, whom he married anyway, tried to force into the traditional role of a housewife, until that woman said, "Fuck it, I'm Lisa Bilyeu, bitch," and became a self-help guru herself. The two of them created their own podcasts each, plus their couples podcast, where they give out basic bitch relationship advice for clout, plus have interviewed Rachel and Dave Hollis. I'm just hoping that Tom and Lisa follow Rachel and Dave's trajectory and get divorced for Lisa's sake, and we'll get into why. Tommy Wiseau dreamed of making movies, but wasn't accepted by traditional Hollywood. So instead, he founded his own multi-million dollar business ventures, mostly in San Francisco real estate, then used those funds to create his own movies, including The Room, in which he was in a relationship with a woman named Lisa who's way out of his league, and also he was dressed like this. Tom Bilyeu, another Tom, or Tommy if you will, dreamed of making movies, but somehow failed at that in a way that he does not clearly detail in any of his work, so instead he founded his own multi-billion dollar business, Quest Nutrition, then used some of those funds to create his own show, Impact Theory, in which he's in a relationship with a woman named Lisa, who's way out of his league, and he dresses like this. From all of this, I have concluded that Tom Bilyeu is more meme than man, and therefore deserves to be ridiculed at all costs. Now recently, one of my YouTube friends, MacAttack, did a video reacting to Tom Bilyeu's keynote speech. And in this, I noticed Tom kept saying things like,
"When I say take the red pill, what I'm talking about is waking up to the way the world really is."
So I thought, okay, well, Tom used to be a film professor, right? And in a lot of his videos, he quotes and references movies all the time. So maybe he's just a really big fan of The Matrix, right? Maybe that's all he means when he keeps saying, take the red pill. But then I saw more and more, until the potential manosphere connections became so big that they were impossible to ignore. I'm in a Charlie Day kind of mood today, so let's see what connections we can draw from this. But first, what does the term red pill even mean? The red pill is a famous piece of imagery from the 1999 movie The Matrix. In The Matrix, Neo is offered two options, to take the red pill or the blue pill. If he takes the blue pill, life as he's always known it will continue. That life is an illusion, but he can choose to live his life in that illusion, unaffected by the truth, living in pursuit of pleasures in the moment. But if he takes the red pill, he'll see the world as it really is. Life may be more difficult, but life will be honest and authentic. After choosing to take the red pill, Neo finds that life as he knew it was an illusion all along. Since The Matrix came out, many people have used this metaphor as a way to describe what it means to choose to see reality even when it's painful, versus choosing to live in whatever perception of life is most beneficial to you. But no one has popularized the term red pill as much as the manosphere. According to Wikipedia, the manosphere is a collection of websites, blogs, and online forums promoting, to varying degrees, masculinity, misogyny, and opposition to feminism. Communities within the manosphere include men's rights activists, incels or involuntary celibates, maidenless people, men with no bitches, Men going their own way, pickup artists, and fathers' rights groups. The manosphere overlaps with the far-right and alt-right communities. It has also been associated with online harassment and has been implicated in radicalizing men into misogynist beliefs and the glorification of violence against women. A central tenet is the concept of the red pill, a metaphor borrowed from the film The Matrix. It concerns awakening men to the supposed reality that society is dominated by feminism and biased against men. Manospherians believe that feminists and political correctness obscure this reality, and that men are victims who must fight to protect themselves. Accepting the manosphere's ideology is equated with taking the red pill, and those who do not are seen as blue-pilled or as having taken the blue pill. Such terminology originated on the anti-feminist subreddit r/theredpill and was later taken up by men's rights and MGTOW sites. Donna Zuckerberg writes, "The red pill represents a new phase in online misogyny. Its members not only mock and belittle women, they also believe that in our society, men are oppressed by women. Men are commonly divided into alpha and beta males with an evolutionary psychology framework where alphas are seen as sexually dominant and attractive to women who are hardwired to want sex with alphas but will pair with beta males for financial benefits." And guys, I know more about red pill ideology than I probably should. Sorry, it's not an ideology, it's a praxeology, as they'll remind you every single time you dare to refer to being red pilled as an ideology or a movement. But Savvy, what is a praxeology? It's something you swallow. About a year ago now, in July of 2021, I actually hosted two very prominent red pill influencers on my second channel, Your Morning Guru. We were doing a week about debates following the Steven Crowder change my mind method, though hoping we could actually go into it with a little more intellectual honesty than Crowder did. During the stream, RK and I interviewed and debated these guys about what it meant to be red-pilled, about what the manosphere was, and why they believed in these fundamental social, cultural, and biological differences between men and women. One thing I found very interesting during this discussion was that the men we interviewed mentioned multiple times that they did not like one particular person, whom many consider to be one of the most prominent figures in this type of thinking. That is, Canadian psychologist Jordan Peterson.
"First, breasts, 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 breasts. And second, come, 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 come."
Now, I don't want this video to delve too deep into Jordan Peterson because I'm actually planning to do an entire deep dive on him to come out within the next 2 months. There's a lot to unpack with Jordan Peterson, and I've noticed that if you don't do so in an extremely long-winded and overly thorough way, his fans tend to react like this. However, all of that aside, these creators are connected in their core belief that men and women inherently function differently in the world and as a result need specific bits of advice if they are to attract the high value types of partners that they want. They believe in monogamy and enforcing gender roles as a way to maintain cultural and social order within a given society. And while many like Peterson will often cloak their beliefs behind the idea of freedom of speech,
"Up yours, woke moralists. We'll see who cancels who."
Their beliefs about the need for enforced order within a society seem to run counter to the idea of personal freedom. But again, we'll dive more into Peterson himself in a couple months. But for now, let's talk about today's subject, Tom Bilyeu, and where exactly he fits into all of this. One obvious connection is that Tom Bilyeu seems to be a fan of Jordan Peterson and his work. He follows him on pretty much every social media platform and has interviewed him on his show. Although those things alone don't indicate that he endorses Peterson's views or agrees with him or supports him. Remember, I had red pill influencers on my show about a year ago at this time, and I follow people on social media like Classically Abby as a way to keep up with others' views for potential video topics. So follows and platforming alone don't necessarily equal endorsement. But after watching the episode where Tom interviews Jordan Peterson, it becomes clear that, yes, Tom is on board with JP and his methods.
"It's a pleasure to be here. Appreciate the invitation.
Man, I am beside myself with excitement to have you on, and for a few reasons. One, you've had massive influence over the way that I think, and you have been a guiding light. I never intended to get involved in the culture wars. That's not where I thought my voice was going to be. But your idea of having to face things courageously and not basically just try to hide in the basement, and I realized that I was doing that I was trying to avoid those topics because I was afraid of them. And that didn't make me feel good about myself. And so I think a lot about identity. And one of the things that I'm always telling people is money, success, fame, all that stuff is irrelevant. What matters is how you think about yourself when you're by yourself.
And okay, so this notion of identity that we're being fed is very, very, it's very thin.
What are we being fed? Be very specific.
Well, there is the idea, for example, that your identity is whatever you say it is and that everyone else has to go along with that. No, that isn't how it works, partly because no one even knows how to go along with it. Like, let's say, just for example, that you're gender non-binary. Okay, what am I supposed to do about that? Man, I don't know, I hardly know what to do if the rules are already there. So let's say I grow up, I want to, being a heterosexual male, I want to find a woman, fall in love with her, raise a family, have children, have grandchildren. That's a game. I know the rules to it. Not well, because everyone's a failure at that. You know, it's very difficult, but at least you kind of know what the goal is, and so does the person you're with. Well, you leap out of that, which is already terribly difficult. You leap out of that into completely unknown territory, saying that I'm presenting yourself as something other than those categories leaves everyone around you and you completely bereft of direction.
First, breasts, 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 breasts. And second, come.
And again, we'll get more into discussions about Jordan Peterson's distrust of LGBTQ people in my deep dive on him next month. Plus, being open to listening to Jordan Peterson's ideas doesn't in a vacuum on its own make you a red pillar or a follower of the manosphere or a misogynist. Actually, none of these things on their own individually do. It's when you put them all together that the picture starts to form. And the moment it came together for me was when Tom was talking to his wife, Lisa, on one of his relationship theory podcast episodes about his belief in a concept called sexual market value, or SMV. According to a 2018 paper from the journal Men and Masculinities called Digesting the Red Pill, Masculinity and Neoliberalism in the Manosphere, Sean P. Van Valkenburg from the University of California, Santa Barbara's Department of Sociology writes, considering the extant literature on the manosphere, it is perhaps unsurprising that the sidebar, and sidebar here refers to the manifesto that is posted on the actual sidebar of the Red Pill subreddit page, the sidebar would favor EP as its patron discipline, but the sidebar also holds neoclassical economics and rational actor theory in high regard. Indeed, the sidebar can also be characterized by its explicit application of a neoliberal economic ideology to sexual relationships. Implying some familiarity with neoclassical economics, the sidebar openly values academic works that apply economic principles to sexual relations. Gary Becker was the first to describe human behavior in terms of economics. Roy Baumeister further refined the idea. A heterosexual community can be analyzed as a marketplace in which men seek to acquire sex from women by offering other resources in exchange. Societies will therefore define gender roles as if women are sellers and men are buyers of sex. Societies will endow female sexuality, but not male sexuality, with value, as in virginity, fidelity, chastity. The sexual activities of different couples are loosely interrelated by a marketplace instead of being fully separate or private, and each couple's decisions may be influenced by market conditions. Notably, economist and rational choice theorist Gary Becker is indexed here as an academic patron saint. So too is Roy Baumeister, whose sexual economics theory overtly attempts to fuse economics and EP. The academic status of these authors functions to legitimize several of the sidebar's key sexual economic concepts, including the sexual marketplace and the sexual social market value. The sidebar sexual marketplace is characterized by the sexual economy of supply and demand for sex and relationships. As such, it is a blatant attribution of capitalist economic logic to sexual relationships in which women become sellers and men become buyers of sex. In sex, as in other matters, the buyers, not the sellers, ultimately determine the price. And the buyers, by and large, are merely average men. This model relies on a neoclassical economic emphasis on individual decision-making and rational choice, though preferences and scarcities can affect how these decisions take place.
The price of sex, for instance, is not determined by the cost of labor, but by decisions of individual buyers and sellers, echoing neoclassical economics on price formation. Sexual market value, SMV, in turn, is one's worth in the sexual marketplace, often conflated with one's attractiveness. SMV amounts to a quantification of sexualized human bodies, reducing them to rationalized exchange values and rendering them commensurable in the sexual marketplace. This is all to say that the manosphere and those who follow red pill ideology, sorry, praxeology, believe in this concept of sexual market value. This belief is often coupled with the gross oversimplification of how human evolution has worked over the past few millennia. So after I gave Tom Bilyeu the benefit of the doubt that maybe he really was just a big fan of the Matrix and maybe he just had no idea that an entirely different group of people who had no relation to him was also using that same metaphor from that same movie for more sinister purposes, I pulled up a video of Tom and his wife Lisa on their joint podcast called Rise Together. No, sorry, that's Rachel and Dave's very similar podcast. This identical podcast is called Relationship Theory. And here was what Tom had to say.
On this, I'm just completely unafraid. Like if people get upset, like that makes me sad because they are rejecting something that is just true about the human experience.
That's just science.
And if you look at humans on an evolutionary timescale, nature had to incentivize certain behaviors. Nature had to incentivize sex so that you would procreate and that we'd have children. So that is a strategy that Mother Nature used. Now, Mother Nature needs to incentivize certain behaviors. So Mother Nature says, hey, don't just mate. Mate with somebody who's likely to be reproductively successful. So that happens to be tied to youth. The older women get, they move into what's actually a really interesting part of human evolution, which we'll call the grandmother phase. So you don't die when you're no longer reproductively available. How interesting is that? The fact that wisdom and caretaking, all of those things, like they end up being so valuable that even post-menopause, there's such a powerful role to be had that you can live for decades, sometimes longer after menopause than before. I mean, that to me is really fascinating. But nature says, but sexually, I don't focus on the grandmas, okay? They have a totally different role. I want you to focus on the ones that are most likely to get pregnant. Now, this is where we can go so deep down this rabbit hole. We are the only species, women are the only half of a species that obfuscates, hides your, when you're reproductive. So now it's like, okay, well, if I don't know when you're ovulating, then I need to just have signals. Youth is one of them. Youth is probably the biggest one, but hip to waist ratio is another one. Bust size is another one. All things that indicate that not only are you of like prime reproductive age, but that you have the resources, the just available amount of fat on your body to sustain having a child. So now it's like nature's going, yo, I've given you all these signals, dear men, look for those and go after those signals. So if nature has given that signal, you can imagine that she deeply embeds then my like impulse towards those signals. If you ask women what age group of man they find attractive, it's always a 4-year range around their age. So when you're 20, you find guys from 18 to 22 attractive. When you're 40, you find guys from 38 to 42 attractive. It just slides. So whatever age you are, like that's your range. Guys, no matter what their age, 13, 73, they find women who are 22 attractive. It never changes. So that is like, that's the physics of being human. That is the nature of it.
That's just science.
Aristotle once said, "The more you know, the more you realize you don't know." This concept often makes it difficult to get into arguments with people like Tom who have this set idea of what constructs the true human experience. The truth is, human evolution is so incredibly complex and varied that most of it isn't even fully understood yet. So in a lot of these places, I can't necessarily prove Tom wrong definitively with facts and logic, but what I can do is point out that a lot of these things aren't completely fixed, and that they're often more multifaceted and nuanced than can fit neatly into a podcast episode. For example, Tom talks about Mother Nature incentivizing reproduction. I mean, that sounds logical, right? And to an extent, it absolutely is. I do think it's a little weird the way he anthropomorphizes Mother Nature as if nature itself is a sentient being. And yes, I get that he's using personification as a literary technique, but to me it feels out of place in a section about the objective realities of the human experience and the physics of being human. In the physics of being human, or the biology of it, nature isn't a sentient creature pulling levers from inside a mech or pushing buttons on a computer screen. Or if she is, you'd better show me her XX chromosome. Checkmate, woke leftist moralists.
We'll see who cancels who.
But all that said, yes, it is true that species that reproduce tend to live on for longer. Adaptability breeds evolution. That's a very 101 level understanding of it, and it's not wrong. We also need to keep in mind, though, that the way humans specifically have evolved does vary from non-human animals due to us living in a post-industrial world, including advances in modern medicine. Over time, species tend to evolve in ways that cut out genetic mutations that aren't beneficial to survival and adaptability in their environment. However, humans don't always do the same due to the ways we've been able to supersede that through medicine and technology. For example, most people who develop cancer in their life do so after the ages where they'd be reproducing. So as a result, we haven't necessarily bred out traits that are related to the susceptibility of getting cancer. Along with that, the fact that for humans, adaptation to our environment can come from our own technological and medical developments, rather than from just breeding for the healthiest or most breedable traits, allows us to have a bit more personal choice and personal freedom that other animals may not get to have, or may not have the same mental decision-making capacities to get to have. So for example, fertile humans can choose to get a vasectomy or a tubal ligation, and infertile humans can choose to do IVF. My point is, evolution and its relationship to sexual attraction is not as black and white and cut and dry as a lot of people want to make it out to be. And when people try to get this black and white, good and bad type of binary, we end up with levels of eugenics apologism that would only sexually attract the wrath of Khan. But Tom uses this basic bit of evolutionary knowledge to draw some very interesting conclusions.
One thing that I find really, really interesting, if you ask women what age group of man they find attractive, it's always a 4-year range around their age. So when you're 20, you find guys from 18 to 22 attractive. When you're 40, you find guys from 38 to 42 attractive. It just slides. So whatever age you are, like, that's your range. Guys, no matter what their age, 13, 73, they find women who are 22 attractive. It never changes.
That's just science.
Tom doesn't cite his source here, but from doing some digging around online, I can guess that he might be referring to the book Dataclism, written by OkCupid co-founder Christian Rutter, which uses data from his dating site to determine what ages men versus women find most attractive or are most likely to pursue. And this data shows one potential conclusion, but Dataclism, published in 2014, doesn't tell the full story. 3 years later, in 2017, a peer-reviewed article from the Academy of Finland found that men and women actually didn't show much variation in the ages of their desired sexual partners. The article says, "The difference between men and women with respect to their age preferences when it comes to sexual partners is smaller than earlier believed. A recent study shows that also men become interested in older and older women as they themselves age. While earlier research has indicated that even older men prefer young women, a recent study suggests that this is only partly true. It is true that men, more than women, tend to maintain a sexual interest in younger partners. Contrary to what has been reported from earlier studies, most men and women are also sexually interested in partners their own age throughout life. Most sexual activity occurs between partners of approximately the same age. Homosexual and bisexual men and women differ very little from their heterosexual counterparts. The only exception from this is that homosexual men are somewhat more likely than bisexual and heterosexual men to have sex with partners younger than themselves." So this was based on a study of 878 adult men and 1,789 adult women published in the journal Evolutionary Psychology. So who's right here? In different circumstances, probably both of these are right for the specific set of circumstances that they analyzed. That's my whole point. None of this is cut and dry like Tom is making it out to be. There isn't hard proof that these tenets of the physics of being human and the truth of the human condition and how they relate to the sexual market value are these set in stone, hard truth type of. And to treat it like it's a black and white, true or false type of conclusion ignores so much more of the information that is still out there that we have yet to study. And so many of the varying factors that could go into challenging these results. Remember, Aristotle, the more you know, the more you realize you don't know.
The older women get, they move into what's actually a really interesting part of human evolution, which we'll call the grandmother phase. So you don't die when you're no longer reproductively available. How interesting is that? The fact that wisdom and caretaking.
So who's gonna tell Tom Bilyeu about MILFs? Regarding this grandmother phase, I couldn't find much about that when I tried to research it, but I did find an article from the 2021 Smithsonian Magazine about this idea of the grandmother hypothesis, coined by anthropologist Kristen Hawkes while studying a hunter-gatherer society called the Hadza in Tanzania. Over decades of research, Hawkes found that grandmothers, when their daughters were in their most childbearing years, tended to take on the work of gathering the vegetables and doing that kind of stuff so that their daughters could focus on giving birth and caring for the new children and all of that. So while this hypothesis does play out in that specific society of people over the specific decades that Hawke studied them, that is since the 1980s, there isn't a lot of proof out there that this hypothesis indicates a universal human truth. According to Smithsonian Magazine article itself, it's heartwarming to think of grandmothers as evolutionary heroines, especially in the face of an alternative narrative, that postmenopausal women merely represent evolution's failure to sustain fertility throughout a woman's entire life. But to skeptics, the grandmother hypothesis remains a just-so story, a tidy narrative that can't be proven or disproven, which is the burden of science. Nonetheless, the grandmother hypothesis hints at broader mysteries and controversies about the human lifespan, women's bodies, and to what extent health declines as a result of menopause. Evolutionary biologists and anthropologists have spent decades trying to figure out why female humans outlive their fertile period when few other animals do. The grandmother hypothesis originated with a 1957 paper by the late ecologist George C. Williams, but more recently Hawkes has carried the torch for grandmother's role in evolution. Chimpanzees, our closest mammalian relatives, and other great apes do not typically live past menopause, and most don't even experience it. The killer whale and pilot whale are rare examples of mammalian species in which females continue living after they can no longer reproduce. A 2019 study shows that grandmother whales increase the survival of their aquatic grandkids. For example, grandmothers can lead the group to food when there are fewer salmon around. Donna Holmes Parks, associate clinical professor of biology at the University of Idaho, argues that long lifespans among humans is a modern phenomenon. Ancient humans rarely lived beyond 50 years, and prior to the Industrial Revolution, most people tended to die by 35, the age at which fertility starts to decline in both sexes. Life expectancy from birth in the U.S. in 1900 was 45. Over the course of the 20th century, as modern medicine entered the scene, it climbed to 78 to 80 years old, she writes. But Hawkes and others counter that in previous eras, many more babies and juveniles died young, lowering the average age of death. They point to difference between life expectancy and lifespan potential, of which the latter is much longer. And then a related question arises. How old is menopause? If menopause is a recent phenomenon, then scientists have a harder time arguing that postmenopausal grandmothers have so strongly shaped human evolution. If menopause is ancient, anthropologists expect to find commonality and all the symptoms that women experience regardless of their ethnicity. But Lynette Sievert, biological anthropologist at the University of Massachusetts Amherst, is skeptical. She's done fieldwork on menopause in many communities worldwide, from Bangladesh to Mexico to Hawaii. Her work has found that while women in some cultures may say they do not experience hot flashes, monitoring devices on volunteers in those groups show that actually hot flashes are common. These women just don't talk about them. Sievert says that the universalities of the menopausal experience across the world suggests a shared experience of estrogen decline at midlife. Hot flashes may have ancient roots. While no one can observe the hot flashes of Homo erectus, Sievert and others say that humans and their ancestors have gone through menopause for at least 1 million, even up to 1.8 million years, even before anatomically modern Homo sapiens. Even if menopause is truly ancient, some detractors of the grandmother hypothesis point to the health perils of a woman's post-fertile years to argue that this stage of life is not adaptive. Maintaining that postmenopausal womanhood did not result from the selection of inherited beneficial traits over time. Many of the common health problems of aging can be traced to physiological phenomena that are beneficial in younger people, Park says. Estrogen is essential for fertility, but in later years, the decline of estrogen puts women at risk for osteoporosis on top of the unpleasant and sometimes serious symptoms of menopause itself. Decreases in estrogen may also contribute to the risk of heart disease and dementia. If grandmas are so important to their relatives, why isn't health in general stable from menopause onward, Parks writes in an email. Sievert agrees that grandmothers have played an important role in helping their children and grandchildren, but for her, it's not the answer to why women live beyond their fertile years and past menopause. What set up our species to have post-fertile grandmothers around in the first place is that women are born with all the eggs they will ever have. Other animals like fish, amphibians, and most reptiles produce eggs throughout their lives. So females will never experience menopause or live in a post-menopausal state in species other than humans. But basically, once again, guys, evolution is incredibly complex. Human attraction is also incredibly complex. And Tom, the more you learn, the more you'll realize that you don't know yet. So let's not make these hard cut and dry statements about universal truths of being human and the factual differences between men and women and their sexual market value. So what is the truth? Is Tom Bilyeu a red pillar? Is he a gateway to the manosphere? Well, like Aristotle said, the more you know, the more you realize you don't know. And the more I learn about Tom Bilyeu, the more I can say that I don't know for sure where his heart is. I can easily believe that he just really happens to like The Matrix, great movie by the way, to the point of using red pill imagery as a metaphor for his life, and maybe the other red pillar groups out there came up with that completely independently on their own separately and they never interacted. Maybe that's true, and maybe that's true while he simultaneously listens to Jordan Peterson and also believes in sexual market value and also believes that there are hard black and white evolutionary truths about the ways men and women are attracted to one another that stand the test of time. Maybe all those things are just true about Tom by chance. It wouldn't be the first time, as the man does have an uncanny amount in common with both Dave Hollis and Tommy Wiseau without managing to actually be either one of them. So the same can be true for the red pill community. Sorry, movement. Sorry, ideology. Sorry,
praxeology.
Like everything else in life, it could all just be a coincidence. But I think it's a lot more likely that there's something deeper going on here. A man who marries his own student pressures her into a housewife role that she never wanted, which we're going to talk about when we review Lisa Bilyeu's book next week, the ways that she basically had to act like Tom's mom when she got married to him and he pressured her to stay in the house for 8 years while he went to work and they didn't have kids. So she wasn't a stay-at-home mom, like he had her be a stay-at-home wife and made her like make him dinner constantly and set out his clothes for him. Maybe that's why she dressed him like Tommy Wiseau, I don't know. But when you got a man who does that with his own student and then publicly also uses language about red pills and sexual market value and the hard truth of evolutionary psychology, guys, I don't trust him. So we'll find out more about this next week when I review his wife Lisa's book called Radical Confidence here on this channel. I'll see y'all in the meantime though. Please keep on supporting small businesses. Have a fantastic start to your Friday. Bye.
Get you some nuts.
There was lots of memes.
Makes me wonder if I should take up lesbianism.
Chicago.
You guys asked for it.